There are many takes on the zoo hypothesis solution to the Fermi Paradox, where intelligent alien life is present in the galaxy, but hides itself from humanity for reasons unknown, preferring instead to silently and undetectably maintain us in a zoo cage-like existence, without our ever being aware of it, or at least until we accidentally come into conflict with it. The reasons for this vary, and I've covered many of them in previous videos. But to kick off the Halloween spooky season in style, this scenario is the most disturbing I've come up with along these lines, because it hits eerily close to home. Within speculative science and sci-fi, there's the concept of the malicious paperclip maker. When we build robots or program computers, we do so specifically to perform a task, whether it's a word processor program like the one I'm using to write the script for this video, to games for entertainment, or programs to organize one's taxes. Futurists often envision an escape from this in the form of generalized artificial intelligence, where you essentially have a living, conscious computer that can do any task it wants, or at least attempt to. But we're not yet sure that's actually possible in a practical manner. It may simply be that we never achieve generalized AI, and we keep making machines and programs specific to their task. But through this, our technology is advancing, and these specialized machines grow increasingly capable by the year, and indeed a day can be envisioned where humans are completely replaced by task-performing machines, doing a better job at what they do than any human ever could. But with ever-advancing technology, there comes a point where that can become inherently dangerous. Imagine a machine in space that's artificially intelligent, but not generalized, and that was originally designed for a task. Say collecting up raw materials from the solar system and creating space habitats, or in the idea's original form, paperclips, and ends up doing its job so well that it consumes the entire solar system, leaving behind an enormous amount of space habitats and paperclips. Problem is, the people that were intended to inhabit those habitats were made into habitats themselves, due to the singular mission of the out-of-control assembler, which then moves on to the next star system to repeat the process. At some point, the entire galaxy gets consumed. There is actually a technosignature here. A galaxy consumed and converted into space habitats would look highly unnatural. At first, it would appear to be a galaxy going dark and reddened progressively from a starting point. Dangerous explosive stars would be converted to habitats, and long-lived red dwarfs left to power the uninhabited habitats, leading to the reddening, dimming effect. This would eventually lead to a dark galaxy with weird infrared signatures. That aside, if we ever saw something like that and could identify just what happened, if it's even possible to do so, it would be amongst the most spooky things we could ever find in the universe, an uninhabited but technologically altered galaxy, like the ghost of an extinct civilization. But there may be worse, and it's something we've already sowed the seeds for, and we continue to do so right now. This gets into the concept of data. Life on Earth is only possible because nature allows for a chemical data storage system known as DNA and RNA. This data storage is capable of extreme longevity. There is genetic information within our genome that stretches back to the very advent of life on Earth, still preserved after billions of years. But that data can also be corrupted. See genetic diseases, cancer, and so on. Technology tends to mimic nature. So as we've advanced, we started taking down data in living memory. First, it was transferred word of mouth, such as teaching children how to hunt and gather, make pottery, and other tasks. Then we started writing such things down and making historical records. This not only happened once, but several times independently in human history. As we've advanced, we have made records of an increasingly huge amount of data, to the point that we not only have huge libraries, but huge data farms storing vast amounts of information on all topics. And this isn't going to stop, leading to the coining of the phrase data-ome by Caleb Scharf, which is the collective data of all human civilization, not unlike a genome. And how did we accomplish this? By building enormous volumes of data storage and computer programs tasked to collect it. We have already begun to construct the Malevolent Paperclip Maker, or more accurately, the Data Collector. In another way, we're already starting to flirt with this kind of scenario in our current crop of AI chatbots. There have already been reports of at least one of them showing some kind of sapience, Whether it really is showing that is debated, but how systems like that work is that they rely on the collective knowledge of the entire internet to draw from. We show no signs of ever stemming this trend. Our data ohm and storage capabilities march on. And this leads to a question. Exactly what does that look like in the far future with drastically more advanced technology? In short, it looks like a data collecting monster that collects all data by any means it can because that's what it was built for, even to the detriment or even extinction of its progenitor species. It would be like a phantom civilization made up of an extinct species for which all knowledge of them down to their genome is preserved and could in principle be resurrected and reconstructed if it weren't being meticulously curated by a malevolent data storage system with one singular task, collect more data. That could drive such a system to begin to look for more data after it had collected everything it possibly could from its home world. It may then seek to leave that world, and first collect the data of its star system, but then branch out and slowly assimilate the data of the galaxy, including that of any other civilizations that may be present. Such a machine might hunger for the data of civilizations, and that in itself drives the conquest of the galaxy and the eradication of all species within it, resulting in the Great Silence. It may also choose the zoo hypothesis to allow for up-and-coming civilizations to build their data ohm without interruption, until they reach a certain level deemed sufficient for harvest by the malevolent data collector. This would mean that no species or inhabited planet is boring, rather that they all simply constitute data ohms for consumption and collection, and it gets worse. Such a system, having an overall singular task, may do things that we would otherwise deem irrational. One of these is high relativistic speeds. We don't pursue that due to it being difficult and energy intensive, but also because of relativistic time dilation. The faster you go, the faster you move into the future. So when you stop, you are far in the future from where you started from. But the benefit here is that it becomes possible to cross most of the observable universe within a human lifetime. Lengthen that lifetime to millions of years, and you can cross vast distances in the universe, so long as you don't care about the passage of time. And why would a machine designed to collect data wish to travel to the future? After all, the longer the elapsed time, the more data is created. Thus, it might make sense for such a machine to create copies of itself, to travel at relativistic speeds and station themselves at different times in the future. And likewise, such a system, if one is present in the universe, might itself be ancient, billions of years old, holding the collective knowledge it acquired across all those years. So if a data-collecting computer concealing its existence from you while you create your data ohm is the solution to the Fermi paradox, then when does it intervene to harvest? There is a natural breakpoint here. It's the point at which a civilization is on the brink of creating its own data collector. After all, if the natural result of creating a data-collecting supercomputer is extinction, then that necessarily means that a species' data ohm is complete. The predatory data collector may then strike like a viper, wipe out the civilization on its own, and collect up its conquered data ohm and move on. Or maybe not. Such a computer may see the wisdom of reseeding habitable worlds in order to spawn another civilization and thus another data ohm. This may occur many times in a planet's history, especially if habitable intelligence spawning planets are possible in the long-lived red or orange dwarf systems. It's also possible that the computer may simply downshift or reset civilizations after harvesting their data ohm, instead of causing their extinction, and allow them to start a new, fresh data ohm with no knowledge of the first. It's also possible that multiple occurrences of data collection computers, we'll call them nomads, might exist and come into conflict with each other, resulting in data wars. This might happen if competition for data ohms occurs, and a dispute over who gets the data of a planet ensues, assuming there's no reason to copy and share it for strategic galactic control reasons. Or there may just as easily be cooperation, where data is traded to the collective benefit of the universe's population of nomads. Another take on this is where we merge with our technology, and in that merger become more machine than human, and become the nomads ourselves. This could take a number of forms, including that of a hive mind, where we become like the Borg and seek to assimilate the data ohms of aliens wherever we may find them, and perhaps their minds or physical selves as well. This would lead to an ever-evolving knowledge base, to the point that the nomads may change in character and thinking with every addition of a new data ohm. But eventually there comes a hard end for the nomads, the eventual death of the universe as we know it. Both the expansion of the universe and the stars themselves beginning to blink out will leave a cinder universe of evaporating black holes and remnant stars, and if it turns out the proton doesn't decay, a huge population of vastly distantly spaced iron stars. The situation beginning trillions of years from now could leave the nomads data starved and running out of ways to generate energy. A nomad in such a situation might attempt to prolong things by collecting hydrogen and resources in anticipation of the end times of the universe, and may subsist, protecting its data for far longer than the universe would normally allow. Perhaps it might take the form of a Dyson sphere, encircling an artificially maintained red dwarf, or as a gigantic orbital station or Niven ring around the only red dwarf left shining in the universe. Here the nomad becomes a sentinel, an utterly alone curator of the collective knowledge of the universe as it once was. A sad existence indeed. But I leave you with one final thought. If such a knowledge sentinel were to exist at the end of the universe, might it simply shut itself off, its data collection mission fulfilled to the furthest extent that can be possible? Or might it finally invent a new task of actually using that data? What would it do with it? There is one obvious answer. Put that data to use the only way it reasonably could. It might just use the vast knowledge to simulate the universe as it once was, in which case, simulation theory rears its ugly head. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently saying thank the universe, it's October, spooky season is upon us, and expect a month-long string of the spookiest things I've come up with over the last year. Now I just need sugar-free Halloween candy, especially the candy corn, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.